Коллеги, давайте. Да, будем с места выступать.
Dear colleagues, it's high time we started our session. We have the strongest people here in the hall. We have the honor to finalize our forum this year. Our session is one of the last ones, but nevertheless, it is one of the most interesting at the forum. Featured at this conference on the Arctic issues at previous sessions and at the plenary session, we heard a lot about the issues related to transport along the route, as well as other issues related to the Arctic, The theme of the Arctic is extremely popular in recent times, and in many episodes, we saw a lot of projects presented to us, and we know that our country, with this icebreaker which was put to water not long ago, is making enormous progress in this regard. When we discuss the Arctic zone, we can face a number of issues and discuss economics and economic development and growth, and we regard this region as one of the possible transport routes, which is currently underused. Last year, our president asked the government to calculate a financial model of the Northern Sea Route and the opportunities to use it both for domestic and international carriages and shipments. The Ministry of Far Eastern Development leads the way in this process, and so far we have reached certain results, and I would like to give a floor to Igor Stepanov, Deputy Prime Minister, State Secretary, to make a short introduction on the general progress. I will repeat that we are limited in time, so I will ask every speaker to speak not more than 7 minutes, and after each statement we will have an opportunity for short Q&A sessions, so please stick to the schedule. The objective which we had and mentioned by Konstantin was an ambitious one, but at the same time it was very interesting to address this issue. Our objective is to create a new way, a new transit route, and provide a commercially viable project and product which will provide a natural transport corridor connecting Asia and Europe. To address this issue, we want to boost a number of addressing a number of issues of the Arctic regions and the whole Russia. We want to address both economic, social, and technical issues which we have in the northern regions of our country. When we started our work, we used the help of our analytical center. Without them, it would not have been possible. And we identified a number of infrastructural challenges. At the moment, the Northern Sea Route is the northern imports of necessary routes and shipments, as well as the loading and unloading operations of natural resources and raw materials. And the distribution of activities is uneven in the western and eastern parts. In the western part, we have easier ice conditions in the Kara Sea, for example. There we have a better infrastructure, and those projects which exist at the moment and the long-term projects which are dedicated to drilling and natural resources are located along the Northern Sea Route. The Northern Sea Route development and making a focus on natural resources leads to an uneven development of this sphere. So the western part is better developed. The eastern part, we think, in such a scenario, will degrade. This is a so-called inertial scenario. We see this standpoint of view, which is in our head, which actually disables us to develop the both parts of the region. Another issue is to provide navigation throughout the whole year until 2030. We will not face significant changes in this regard. And to develop the northern sea routes, we still will need icebreakers and vessels with the ability to support ice conditions. Construction of new icebreakers is not sufficient to support existing operations, and of course it will not be possible to develop shipping operations with that. The company which is operating in the Kara Sea is going to promote the use of vessels of higher ice grade, capable of working in the northern part of the sea route. As you understand, such vessels are more expensive to build, and the using of these vessels disables world companies, world shippers to enter this market. So for those companies who want to reduce the time of shipping of cargoes. We also need to understand the current context of container shipping. At the moment, we have the excessive demand of ice-grade vessels. We know that the freight rates are becoming lower, and in the near 3 years, there will be no further demand driven, and the companies will be reluctant to develop new types of ice-grade vessels. Besides, recently we have seen the new technical disruptive revolution, and as we know, new types of vessels are being developed that help to provide a reduction in transport costs and operational parameters in comparison with the vessels we had several years ago. The comparison of the European route and the northern route shows that the reduction in distance is not economically viable in terms of price and deadlines. This is a very important factor which needs to be mentioned, and which undermines building a conceptual and a competitive model. Yet, on the other hand, we managed to find the only niche to develop this route, and we think this scenario is transit carriages, transit shipments over the Northern Sea route. I'm speaking about the container-delivered cargoes connecting Chinese region, Korea, and the regions along the route. By 2030, we expect the growth of the volumes up to 6.8 TEU, and this model will be only viable if we use the biggest vessels, and such a project at the moment is being developed. We are developing an Arctic icebreaker with the sufficient capacity to provide its commercial use. We will need a sustainable cargo traffic up to 4,000 TEU per year. In this case, we will have to use bigger container ships. For bigger container ships, we will need better and bigger cargo traffic. So that means that the two factors are interrelated. But we also can address this issue, and it can be the solution. A possible solution is sustained in developing the domestic market along the Northern Sea Route. So what kind of steps can we take? We can transfer a share of cargoes from the railroad to the northern sea route. These are the cargoes for the cities located in the Far East. First of all, Petropavlovsk, Kamchatsky, Magadan, and Adyr, which are deprived of automobile roads and do not have a connection with the regions of the Far East. By transferring this cargo traffic to the sea route, which is currently a multimodal route. So at the moment, if we do that, we will be able to raise the amount of traffic. The second important factor in developing the domestic market is to transfer Chinese imports, which is done by railroad, to the European part of the country. So if we combine these solutions, we think by 2030 we will have a double increase in the overall traffic which can be transported along the northern sea route. A competitive model which we are currently developing is about creating a regular container line connecting Murmansk and Petropavlovsk-Kamchatsky. We also expect to modernize the port infrastructure, construct two hubs for loading and unloading operations between regular ships and ice grade ships. The cargoes will be transported as transit cargoes from China as well as cargoes for domestic market. In 10 years, the container line will be developed, and by 2025, we expect that the share of these imports and transport operations will reach 10%. The amount of 160,000 TEUs is the possible figure here, and the operations will support cargo traffic from Europe and actually provide an alternative solution. So for that, to develop a project, we will need contributions and investments from the government, from banks, but we think such a scenario, such a competitive model is competitive and viable. So we will work to make it happen. Thank you for your contribution. You are a bit delayed in time, but I didn't stop you because your presentation was informative. Probably you could give us more comments on the risks which might emerge. Probably you could name a few risks in developing such a model, so that we can concentrate our further discussions on discussing the risks you will mention. First of all, the first risk is the lack of icebreakers and big container ships of ice grade with a high ice grade. This is the first risk. Risk number two is the necessity to transfer existing logistics chains to the northern sea route, and transferring them from railroad to the northern sea route. And risk number three, of the third risk, which is probably a key one, is using the unique experience and best practices which we are currently lacking in developing such routes. We don't have such best practices available at the moment.
And you have mentioned another thing. It is highly unlikely that the investments will be made. True, and yes, by the way, it just occurred to me that the status of the global transportation market, it's stagnating now, and it's we don't know what will happen in the next 2 years. And will you please pass over the control box over here? And I would like to give floor to Mr. Chukovin. He is the first deputy of the governor of Murmansk region. Murmansk, both now and under any circumstances, will be one of the key ports in the Northern Sea route. The more so that under construction now are the port facility. It will be deep water channels in the bay. And yes, do not forget about the risks as well. Thank you, Konstantin. And my presentation was based on the first speaker presentations, and that's something that they have been doing, and I'm a member of the expert committee cooperating with them. And I would like to mention that we have achieved progress, and the contractors of the analytical center and the customers, they have done their ground work, and they looked into the situation, and everyone realized that the NSR will not be a substitute of the Suez Canal, and we should apply the route for haulage of the energy resources that will be produced in Western Siberia. The resources extracted over there are quite huge, and the country is vast, and it is necessary to ensure connectivity between west and east of the country. And of course, the Ministry of the Development of the Far East region are preoccupied primarily with the Far East, and two-thirds of their activities dedicated to the Far East, and it's only one-third of their documentation is dedicated to Murmansk. And actually, there is the note over there that in Murmansk the port is frozen and the icebreakers are needed to escort ships. Anyway, let me clear up the misconceptions, and I will tell you about the Murmansk. We have a number of companies. The reference list is provided over here, and they export their produce using the Kola Bay. And here is a description of the Kola Bay. It is deep water, and it does not freeze in the winter, and it is available for whatever dead weight the vessels have. Of course, there are certain limitations for handling cargo up to 100,000, but anyway, the project that it was referred to reference the development of the transportation hub in Murmansk will increase the capacity of the port. The port was meant for the Arctic, and here is an information to this effect. When Yamal development started, Murmansk port launched ships, and initially there was a Harasaway terminal. Explains that it was specially meant for Yamal. The capacity of the port amounts to a huge amount of oil and gas transshipment. This picture is dedicated to this project as well. The capex is 140 billion rubles, and it's a phased out project. The federal budget allocations are provided. Railroad infrastructure will be constructed. But it's not only the railroad that is being constructed. We had a minister of the transport, Mr. Sokolov, and we showed him around. It's good that the contractor is ahead of the schedule, And we agreed that the contractor will keep working irrespective of how much money is paid, and then the Minister of Transportation will do the settlement at the end of the year. And 2 billion will be allocated in 2016, but the contractor stated that it can spend do the amount of work for the nine that would cost 9 billion rubles. And there are a number of terminals like coal terminal, container terminal, oil and gas terminal, and we launched the project in 2007, and we specified the list of the terminals that will be over there. At the moment, we transship 4 million tons of coal, and SWEC is the owner of the port, and it is the coal company. They undertake measures to decrease the impact on the environment, but the GRAFER technology is used for the transshipment of coal. It is not quite environment friendly. However, the company has plans to increase the transshipment to 18 million tons, but the authorities are against it. We insist on building the terminal on the western coast of the Kola Bay using the state-of-the-art technologies for transshipment. There is another project that was mentioned. I used to work in Norilsk Nickel, and right now we started this work, and right now Murmansk received the first shipment from Dixon, and the transshipment could be done in the open sea. Instead of offloading it in Murmansk. And you can see the figure of 30,000 tons at one go. So there are projects for the construction of the coal terminals on the western bank, on the western coast of the bay. The investment agreement has been signed. And I think you will hear the news about this project in the future. The picture slides the oil tankers in the Kola Bay, both the existing one and those that are under construction. There was a meeting in the Ministry of Energy, and it was stated that we do not have oil in Murmansk region, but we do. And here is a proof of that. And if the oil is offloaded in Murmansk, it will be possible to refine it in the Murmansk region for the benefit of the country. Here is the route from Murmansk to Petropavlovsk, and it will be phased out into three stages. I think theory is not applied well to the Arctic. And we should go step by step with practicalities. We should start doing things, and Sevmorput, that is a northern sea route, did the work. They performed the shipment at the peak of the winter. We need to start the transportation. No need to set up an operator of the shipment of the cargo on the northern sea route. We have quite a number of the shipping companies. There is Atom, Flot, Far East Shipping Company. These companies have competencies that to arrange the carriage, haulage of the cargo on the northern sea route. And the state should take a decision. And this task should be launched. And then, through practical experience, we will keep developing it. Thank you. Your The end of your presentation was the urge for to action. And we have Vladimir Kolchanov, he is the first vice president of the Far East shipping company. And while our next speaker will be getting the control box, I would like to say that his shipping company has got a lot of experience of container shipping. They've got their own ice-breaking fleet, and we are looking forward to his talk, the talk of the professional. Thank you, Konstantin. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues. While I was on my way to the conference, I had a presentation that is used to discuss the issues of Northern Sea Route. We have different conferences and fora to talk about that. But after I attended this particular conference, I realized that many people over here are aware of the basic things. Let me just say a few words of the Far East Shipping Company. We have been working for quite a time, and we started applying icebreakers since 1957, and we have been a public company for more than 20 years. And the economic viability of our project is important. We do not have any donations from the government. And indeed, the Northern Sea Route is a hard passage. And when we review the routes from East to Europe, it turns out that Northern Sea Route is three times shorter than the alternative. And so there is a tight area which is covered by ice. But still, we can save 2,000 miles by taking it. And the practice shows that fuel consumption in the Northern Sea Route is more. The time required to cross the distance is less, but fuel needed is more. The subject matter of the conference is the global Northern Sea Route is the global corridor. And what are the competitors? We say we are competing with the Suez Canal, but it was dug 150 years. Actually, we are competing with the Good Hope Route, Gibraltar, and the Baltic Straits. These are our natural competitors, because the Suez Canal is an instrument. So that's the benchmarking that we should do. But still, this corridor is similar to Trans-Siberian Railroad, only it's on it's offshore. Infrastructure is needed to utilize the Northern Sea Route, and capex are needed, and the major capex are to manufacture icebreakers. It is not possible to arrange shipping without icebreakers. If there are no icebreakers, it's not just to escort. The icebreakers are needed not to escort the ships, but just they have to be there for the shipping companies to dare going over there. And there are many ships that start going only on the precondition that the atom icebreakers are en route. And we will have to think about the fuel endurance, especially for small ships. They will need to replenish the fuel, and the infrastructure along the coast would entail considerable operational costs. OPEX in Suez are low. It's just a number of the locomotive engines. But over here, we need the icebreakers. So we need the payment for the crews, filling stations for the ships, etc. But we need to start doing that. I wouldn't set global tasks like building large container ship. It is possible to do that, but for the stakeholders to get interested in sending cargo along the Northern Sea route, we need to make the route attractive. The more so that the cargo does not belong to the shipping companies. It is owned by the companies in Asia, and economic viability is important for them. And 10% of saving will not make the Asian companies to use Northern Sea route. Insurance is needed. Yes, that's right, but it's not the only factor. There are many risks, and what are the risks that the shipping companies have? Our company operates in the Arctic, and every voyage in the Arctic is an adventure, but no, it's a test of courage. And let me give you another example for the autumn, for the motorists. Like it could be similar to a Paris-Dakar race. It's something different from traveling on the highway in the middle of Europe, and the shipping companies will have to carry all the expendables that will be needed, because it is just not available along the route. And that's why infrastructure is important. And we have to try to recall what was available in the 80s of the 20th century, what things are needed. It is fuel, water, food, ship repair facilities. It should be restored. And ice breakers are needed as well. Lest we built three more ice breakers, there will be no regular shipping on the Northern Sea route. And if it is one voyage from Petropavlovsk, it will be 3,000 containers, like now the TEUs sent are much less. I have used the word adventure, but the adventure might be too costly. And for people who use the southern straits, the Good Hope, Cape, etc., it's a regular voyage. And the shipping company does not think twice about that. It's a regular thing. Well, please mind your time. Okay. What else shall we do besides the technical issues? We need air surveillance, but we'd rather use drones, not manned flights. We have been using drones, and drones should be general purpose, and they should be used by many stakeholders. The police, the geologist, the emergency committee of Russia should use or should rent drones. It's not that all the stakeholders should buy the drones of their own. They'd rather receive drone services from special contractors. And I wouldn't rely, another thing, I shouldn't rely on the information that is provided by the Institute of Arctic. There are satellite imaging available, and if I need a picture of a certain region, It shouldn't be obsolete. It shouldn't be. It should be fresh, like at least 6 days old only. And there is a certain area that is covered by iridium satellites, and that is quite costly. And the ships should exchange maritime charts between one another. But we should cooperate, we should jointly participate in experimental voyages, and we need icebreaker management. Finland had started the refurbishment of Weimar icebreak, and we can refurbish the Russian icebreakers and can still use them for quite a long time.
Thank you for your practical remarks. You were talking about icebreakers, and probably Mr. Vyacheslav Vladimirovich will also provide his comments to us. On the other hand, well, probably you are competing with the Atomros flot, which was regulated for the, which is regulated by the Federal Anti-Monopoly Agency. Well, I think we are not competing with them at the moment. We do our work, and it's sufficient for us. The one point is about rates, which are different. We are based on the TEU tariffs, having this subscriber fee. I think the Northern Marine route, Northern Sea route, needs to have this kind of subscription fee for those who use it, regardless of the loading capacity. I think we need to stick to this subscription fee, so-called subscription fee, which existed in the Soviet time, and develop in this regard, in this term, continue our work. We are a bit delayed, so we really need to step up. So we heard from Murmansk, and we heard the eastern part of the Northern Sea Route. I give the floor to Nikolai Pegin, Director General Development of Kamchatsky Krai Corporation. And please, sir, you have the floor. Good afternoon, distinguished colleagues. Indeed, the Northern Sea Route is a very important trend at the moment, and it is a wide topic for discussion. At the outset, I would like to mention that I do not fully agree with Mr. Tikhavin regarding his definition of the Northern Sea Route and its development. He wants to stick the land-based objectives and wants to address them. On the other hand, we want to have, in any way, an ambitious goal, an ambitious objective to be able to address both issues on top and on the surface. Depending on the format of this development and depending on what we do, what steps we take, we could need, we probably will need the support of the government. So the price and capacity are the two important factors. If the line becomes a competitive solution and if it competes with the existing lines, it will be viable, it will lead to lower rates for transportation. So probably one of the important topics is the following, which is the economic growth of the Arctic zone. This issue is deeply tied to developing a unified and operational transport infrastructure. The objective I'm talking about was mentioned in the president's message, as well as to the outcomes of the first Far Eastern Economic Forum, which took place in Vladivostok. The objectives which have been set out in the previous cases could help us, if we solve them, to make the Northern Sea Route a sustainable transport corridor for the region, and also contribute to building a unified transport, national Arctic transport line. Such a national line could be a significant element to a unified transport infrastructure of the Arctic. It could be a fundamental to building such a route and such a transport infrastructure. It can help. And for that, we need to address a number of issues in organizing the transport corridor. There are a number of management issues to address, as well as understanding the points of entrance to this route, both in the west and the eastern parts. If we develop such a line, it will help develop the territories, the northern territories of our country, and it will help us to develop the Arctic, the potential, the resource potential of the Arctic region, and drive investment projects related to the development of raw materials. It will also help to develop other types of economic growth. The phase growth will also help us integrate the line with other transport corridors and traffics from the ATR countries, from the western coast of America and the northern part of Europe. We think that in this regard, Murmansk and Petrovalodsk-Kamchatsky could be two significant hubs which can contribute to develop the route, and using the feeder scheme, we can develop the route using these two hubs and connect them with the key ports such as Rotterdam, Shanghai, Yokohama, and Busan. The city of Busan in the South Korea is a significant port which positions itself as an important hub for the northern sea route as we move forward. Such an approach, such a scenario, can help us be as efficient as possible and provide good operations for vessels and contribute to developing the economy of the Arctic and along the route. The maximum volume of traffic is about 60 million tons for the international shipments and 50 million tons for domestic shipments. One of the key roles to develop a unified infrastructure in the Arctic is developing container ships and ports, for example, building a container port in Petropavlovsk-Kamchatsky. Petropavlovsk-Kamchatsky is not part of the Arctic zone, but anyway, it could become a significant part of the total infrastructure. You still have 2 minutes to go. Okay. I try to make it short and simple. We want to use our strategic advantage to use the port which is available throughout the year, and in this scheme you see the international routes. You see that the port is located very close to the major international routes. The proximity of Petropavlovsk-Kamchatsky to these routes is also important in terms of its application as a bunker terminal. Its proximity to the major routes and the distance from the average traffic point could give us an opportunity to have a technical deviation which will not affect the economy and the economy of transportation. It will contribute to driving reduction in transport costs for oil fuel and other materials which we can load and transport and ship using the route. This year, the Ministry of Transport is planning to invest significant funds to redevelop the structure of the port, which will help to handle it up to 50 million of tons of cargoes every year. Implementing the plan I'm talking about will help Petropavlovsk-Kamchatsky to open up its potential and become an important transport hub. We think that the unified transport line will become a new corridor of the regional scope, connecting international industrial hubs and consumer points in Europe and ATR. The new transport corridor will become a new power that will help us a significant player and stakeholder in redeveloping and restructuring of the global transport routes. It will help us to drive our geopolitical influence in the Arctic and globally. Thank you. Thank you, Nikolai. So we are on track. So thank you for that. And you mentioned a few points on the macro level, and we all agree with what you were saying. Let us return to reality, and I give the floor to Mr. Puriam, chair of the board of Sofracht. You know that Sofracht company is one of the logistics leaders operating in various regions, including the Northern Sea Route, and Dmitry Yurgevich will present, will introduce some of the practical issues and expertise to all of us. So we really look forward to your practical advice and practical leadership. I really want to meet your expectations. If not, I'm sorry for that. In any way, we will be able at this session to find a possible solution on how to melt the Arctic ice and to be able to compete with the Suez Canal. A few challenges are there in terms of developing the Northern Sea Route. In this slide, you can see that there are some issues to that, and I fully agree with the Ministry of the Far East on the forecast about 5,000 capacity ships. It's really not, could not be an optimistic forecast. In my personal opinion, I really think that until the end of my life, it will not be the case. Of course, there are drivers to developing the Northern Sea Route, and I stick to the opinion of Mr. Chilingarov. There are a number of projects which are being implemented in the West, and they were mentioned by Alexei Mikhailovich. I think that using the practices and using the expertise and the competence we already have and which our specialists have, these are the specialists working in our company as well as in the shipping departments of our regions. We think that the expertise which is available is quite sufficient and quite big. International businesses and our company can operate the existing information, and there is actually a certain so-called myth that the Northern Sea Route is a competitive transit corridor. I don't think this is the case. I think that's more of a dream. We need to dream, but we will not be over-enthusiastic about that. In terms of container transportation, I don't think such an over-enthusiastic attitude is possible and is viable. It's more a domestic transport corridor, an internal corridor, which we need to develop step by step. And when we understand how to operate it domestically, then we will be able to promote such service in other countries. And until that moment, we will be able to develop the sufficient infrastructure for that. The cargo traffic, which exists at the moment, which is loaded and transported using international routes, 95% of cargoes shipped there cannot be tested at such temperatures, such as below minus 30, minus 40 degrees Celsius. And not many types of cargoes can sustain such a big load, such a big, and not many insurance companies will be ready to cover for that. At many conferences, we discussed the possibility of building and establishing a unified operator, and we discussed pros and cons on that. The point is that the existing expertise and competences related to operating the Arctic shipping, we need to consolidate our efforts and consolidate traffic of cargoes. Overregulation is not acceptable. Overregulation of businesses in developing the Arctic route also is not viable. We think that probably the cargoes which we need, which we want to transport over the route, should be provided by the government, by the country itself. We need to further coordinate the logistics and transport processes. Transport in the Arctic is not only about transporting, but also about issues and challenges in offloading, unloading, and loading operations, which are represented in the slide. One of the key challenges which is there is that it's not possible to understand the costs. It's not possible to understand the costs of transportation using the Northern Sea Route. Risks are uncertain, as well as other aspects are also vague. And this is for us an insurmountable barrier which are facing. There are three companies which volunteered, the Far Eastern Company, the Oberon Logistics, and the Far Eastern Shipping Company, and Anatoly Vyacheslavich represents them here. The three of us created a consortium. It now includes three companies, and we want to drive to draft a solution on developing a tariff policy or the rate policy without the practical use of it. We could create such a framework for ship owners and provide them for shipping companies. So these are the participants of the consortium. We signed the consortium agreement about 2 weeks ago, and the subject of the agreement is about developing a framework. We are not discussing, it's not about some binding terms for ship owners. We just want to make ship owners have a transparent understanding on the route policy and to help them understand the viability of using the northern sea route so that they can plan their capacities, they can plan their purchasing, and understand what kind of icebreakers will be needed, etc. We want to provide further support and cooperate with the Ministry of Transport in building a unified transport Arctic model. We really think that together we will overcome these challenges to come up with a unified and sustainable model. So our goals are to develop the route as well as to provide combined transportation and multimodal transportation. The routes we are operating are represented in this slide. In 2014 and 2015, these are the routes which we have been using. The same is the case with the Far Eastern Shipping Company. Even without international cargoes, the Arctic is operating quite a few transport routes and is doing it actively. We really think that the momentum is there, and we need to say thank you to such companies as Nornickel and other resource processing companies because they will support this process. We have provided transport support for the Northern Sea Route and the icebreaker, which is called the Northern Sea Route, actually is now capable of operating in the Arctic. So we really have the sufficient expertise and competences to develop further. Thank you.
Subfraught is a large company. And of course, there are other companies that are involved in logistics along the NSR. I would like to give floor to Onega Shipping CEO, Mr. Alexander Roslikov. They are specializing in the northern logistics. Alexander? Good afternoon. No formal presentation, but I just make you familiar with my opinion on how the Arctic is being developed. We've been working there for 10 years. Indeed, we are a logistics company, and we were providing the consultative services first, and then we were participating in the civil engineering contracts, and we are involved in haulage of our own cargo as well, and the capacity, the volume is not less than 1 million tons a year. So the development of the Northern Sea route, even when there are no icebreakers available, and we for international cooperation with no ports results in a huge exchange of cargo and goods between the countries. Because take Sabetta, for example. It was the backwater, and right now it's a huge city. And the cranes in the port are German. The steel and engineering network for over there, for example, the utility facilities are Russia. And Novatek started investing money into it, and it is beneficial for both the region and the country now. I would like to inform you that there's nothing wrong in the vast distances, though we see that there are three cities along the route. The territory is quite well developed along the distance between Murmansk and Yamal. There is available reliable infrastructure. In the morning session we discussed, hold on, let me read out the title. It was a quote, the will be adjustment to the policies by developing the hubs. The hubs, I think, these or the focal points, these are the areas that in case of local emergency will make it possible to provide assistance earlier than the Emergency Committee of Russia will come in to provide help. It will be possible to provide assistance from certain ports on the way. There was no Sabetta, there was no Warren Day sometime, but right now there are helicopters and hovercraft available in both Warren Day and Sabetta. And if there is ice cover that prevents the ships from approaching the coastal line, it is possible to use hovercraft to operate over there. So I'd like to emphasize once again that infrastructure keeps developing at the expense of the subcontractors that arrive into the area to do work. They construct settlements over there, and of course the workers work on a rotation basis, but they create a livelihood environment. They create environment for the well-being of the people over there. And in Sabetta area, the construction sites keep spreading to the east. There is Kamenny Cape, and a small village that used to be over there is developing, and there's a ship connection from this cape to other destinations. There are both helicopters and hovercrafts available at the cape as well. Previously, of course, there was nothing. There were just locals over there and reindeer herders that would come to the area once in a while. So the Arctic is not only about ice, and it's not only about icebreakers breaking ice, and there is a lot of activity on shore. And because it is true, I can only agree with those who stated that infrastructure is needed to develop things offshore. And when we talk about a land battle, it should be the battle on land, not only in the air. And accordingly, over here, we need not only to master offshore, but onshore as well. And there was a situation when polar bears would be attacking settlements, and people had to hide inside houses. There are many complications in the Arctic, but there is all the possibility to live and work in the Arctic. In general, we hire between 300 and 400 people annually, and that's what we are doing. Alexander, time. And the lanes of the Northern Sea Route is a major project, and I believe in people that will eventually come to work to the north. They will get contracts, or there will be international companies that will win contracts for construction of the infrastructure. I would like to believe, and that the life will be getting only more invigorated, and there are hot hubs, 30 minutes flight by helicopter, and it will only keep getting more vigorous and dense. Thank you, Alexandra. The floor is given to Mr. Vyacheslav Ruksha. He is a CEO of Atom Flot. It is the underpinning of all the activity in the Arctic. Thank you. A good day. I think the picture is a bit old, but I don't see whether you can see the quote from Admiral Makarov, who stated that Russia faces the Arctic Ocean, and with that, the significance of the Northern Sea Route is emphasized, and we need to keep developing the opportunity for navigation across the route. And the route to India actually was envisaged through the north, and at that, a fur used to be hauled to India from the north. Of course, the north is important, the Arctic is important, and it's not only about gas, but even if it's a gas, it should be sold to the east. That's how it was historically, and there were ships that were going there in the 30s, and at the time of war, the significance of the Northern Sea Route was huge. I didn't realize that Admiral Scheer was trying to make it all the way to Dixon's to cut this particular marine lane. And it took very short time to build the Lenin nuclear ice breaker, and it took a little time to build it. And similarly to the Arctic ice breaker, I was still working for the Institute and participating in the design and engineering of the icebreaker, and hopefully it will be launched in 2017, but altogether it took 14 years to do that. And one thing what I would like to remind you of is the high demand for the products of Norilsk Nickel. It was necessary to ensure the economically viable round the year navigation, and I still remember the year of 1998 when the price was 5,000 or 4,000 for 1 ton of nickel, and we just charged 3% with for our nuclear icebreaker fleet, and it was quite a viable situation. And it was then when the Arctic class icebreakers were developed, and what was not achieved at the Yenisei River, and when there were plans for diesel icebreakers were planned, we developed still Taimyr and Vaigach ice breakers. And there's a new generation, LK60. And the reason why there are two possible drafts, take a Gazprom Neft at the shallow waters and the bay, and so that's why two possible draft is meant to ensure the efficiency of the ice breaking escort. So now, Norilsk Nickel, and we have representatives of the Norilsk Nickel over here. They have their Polar Express. It is possible to do without icebreakers to brace Ike if they have ice class ships, but you should think about the velocity, about the speed, and 10 knots is not enough. One can move faster using icebreakers, and the graphs shows that nuclear power was used to ensure around the year navigation. Here is another graph of freight for you. The peaks are different, years, and normally we didn't have a transit potential in the Northern Sea Route. So while some say that Northern Sea Route worked as a transit lane, it is not true. Both the western section of it was used and the eastern section, but it was not a through way, and the transits were just not that many. I can just remember the only case of fertilizer being transported along the northern route as a transit lane to Canada. And now, Yamal region on the whole, and Alban Tas Bay, Gdan, Taimyr, is the area that in the near 10, 15 years will be used as oil and gas producing provinces, because I think the Western Siberia needs more capex to produce hydrocarbons. Well, eventually I will use the same picture and I would put Sovcomflot to the right. I will have their logo. The picture shows that if we use the great port of Sabetta, and I'm not kidding, for the first time we use the port and make the competing logistics for China. And we should resolve this issue, given the oil price and because of the other parameters. Sometimes when I had less work, we were involved in transit. Here is one of the convoys, and it is ARC 4 vessels, large tonnage shipping, and it takes quite a lot of time to to ensure the dead weight of or the tonnage of 50 or 70,000 tons. Here is one of the convoys, and I can assure you that if the traffic is quite heavy, the shipping companies will pay us similarly for passage of the Suez Canal. We had Las Carinas, a Greek shipping company, moving from Iceland to South Korea, and but the fishers from Kamchatka, they made just one voyage, and they said that the charges are too high. But as a matter of fact, the tariffs of middlemen are quite high. So if it's 10, 15 million tons, then the ice-breaking escort does not seem that heavy, because the port charges are even higher. The current phase of the development of the Northern Sea Route is related to hydrocarbon projects. The figures show different projects. We have three long-term contracts. One of the engines or drivers of the growth, the Yamal LNG, the figures show what's the capacity. Then the Novoport field was put on stream. The first oil was produced, though we have seized the business of Alexander Roslikov of Onega Shipping. And another company that has project over there is Norilsk Nickel, and I think Norilsk Nickel will be using icebreakers, at least using one icebreaker instead of five or six of smaller types. And the major project that is in place, and it will be generating millions of tons of products, it is the coal of Taimur Peninsula. And Alexei Tukhavin mentioned the shipment of the coal. We will have to transport anthracite and the other types of coal. And they say that coal share in the energy mix is reducing. But let me assure you that Russian coal will replace the other types of coal, especially at the Chinese market. Yamal LNG is still another project, and the capacity is quite huge, and it will make Murmansk region the site for the construction of the offshore platforms, taking into consideration that the water depth is quite low. It is between 20 and 30 meters. It's time, Mr. Ruksha. Yes, I'm wrapping up. Here is the first gas LNG ship, the first offloading of raw oil, Dudinka, coal, that's how it looks, 160,000 tons. Here is a graph. We subdivided it into three phases. I refer to them as Norilsk stage up to 2008. They had their own fleet. Then there was a period when we didn't have many customers, but now we are on the growth curve. Yamal LNG is one of our major customers. We are not that big. We have the headcount of 2,000. The average wages are 97,000. So let me assure you that our tariffs are modest. It is just enough to earn for a bread and butter. And here are the specification of the nuclear ships, different draft and general characteristics of the icebreakers. Here is the flagmanship. It will be designed, and it is designed, and it will be having the velocity 10 knots, making a canal of 50 meters. and that's quite a good deal. So our task, which Lomonosov has mentioned, we remember the phrase about Siberia, what Lomonosov said, but here is the second half of his freight. Most of the gas to be produced has been of the future has been sold to China, but our task is to arrange the flow of freight to the West as well. That's the task that we should deal with in the future.
Thank you for your presentation. We are delayed here. We see. We now understand why are you here at this session, not the other session which dealt with different issues. But that was just a small joke. A transport guy is to provide satisfaction to the customer. Without the transport traffic, it's not possible to develop any transport capacities. And for the current purpose, our current oil and gas projects in the Arctic are the main driver to develop the route. Viktor Ikonikov, deputy head of government of Arkhangelsk region, we have been extensively discussing St. Petersburg, the Far East, but we all understand that the first Russian port is Arkhangelsk, and we know from history that the first seamen originated from this very region. And I give the floor to our Arkhangelsk region. We understand you have a small port facing ice conditions. So what kind of tools you want to use to overcome the existing challenges? Good afternoon, distinguished colleagues, and thank you for this welcoming and wonderful introduction on our home region, Arkhangelsk. I have a simple presentation on the general guidelines, general objectives we have in the region regarding the Northern Sea route as well as aviation and rail projects, starting from the point of the Northern Sea route. The Northern Sea route is a part of a unified transport infrastructure and framework, which is part of the regional systems. The regional transport system is integrated to the Northern Sea route and vice versa. So first of all, we need to be focused on developing various elements of the transport infrastructure. We need to learn what other regions have in terms of cargo transportation. We need railroads. We need other modes of transport to be sufficiently developed. And using the example of the Arkhangelsk region, our port is covered with ice during the winter season, but yet it's being used, and we also have our own objectives in terms of developing the Northern Sea route. Every port has its own specifics. Comparing our port with Murmansk, we are completely different in terms of conditions. Arkhangelsk port is not a freezing port, is not covered with ice so far. So the transport hub I'm talking about is a unified solution containing the rail terminal, the aviation terminal, and I will talk to you about this a bit later in detail. So to implement such projects as the Northern Sea Route, we need to build on the capacities of the regions and on the expertise which has been sustained to this date. In our first step could include building on these previous projects, which already exist, which will help us to reduce costs. We also will have an opportunity to attract and involve businesses to develop these projects. There is a number of companies which are developing infrastructural projects at the moment in the region. The Atom Zolotek company, which is going to develop the field of the rare metals, so probably one of the ways to further develop our transport opportunities to build a new airport, a new air hub. cooperating of businesses and the government will help us to make projects cheaper and have a better understanding on the general development of the project. Rail projects, railroads, construction and attracting international investments is also a key factor. And here I would like to draw an example of the Belkomur track, which is currently underway. It is a PPP-based project, which is based on a concession agreement. And the project includes a number of important elements, and it has been discussed for quite a long time. It has been extensively developed starting 2015, and today the stakeholders of the project include the government as well as the regions. First of all, our Chinese colleagues. The project has been developed, and the design is already there. It has been approved at various levels, including the regional level, and it's become a priority project to drive the relationships between Russia and China. And we are on the verge of making the concession agreement, which will help us to develop it as we move forward. Not long ago, we got a request from our president on developing the PPP concept. So we want to use it to drive the development of the defense industry. So we think that it's one of the scenarios, it's one of the priorities to develop the projects in the transfer sphere as well. Yesterday, we signed an agreement with Rosoboron Logistics. And we, by doing this, we will support our current efforts. The consortium, which was mentioned here, probably will need to liaise not only with defense industries, but also with civil industries. Last year, at one of the conferences on the Arctic taking place in the Arkhangelsk region, we had speakers on creating, which spoke for creation of a dedicated association to develop the transport industry. We think by doing this, we could include and attract the interests of the government as well as of the business community to develop the investment projects. Just a few more comments on aviation. On our transport aviation hub ranks third in terms of traffic in the northwestern region. It's being dynamically developed, and we are developing a modernization program, which has been completed to a large extent. We want to continue this, and last year we built a good parking lot, and we are planning to add more features to this project. This will be an anchor airport focused on small aviation, first of all. We have two runways. We also have other aviation platforms, which we want to use in the region. These runways will be dedicated to small aviations using two types of aircraft, N2 and IL-410. We understand that we need to develop the transport infrastructure further, and that is one of the key issues of our today's session. Our budget spends 80 million rubles to provide access to distant territories, to remote territories. We also are focused on developing aviation and traffic for passengers. For private passengers, we want to provide better opportunities by means of reduction of rates. For that, we need to reduce costs. To do that, we need better aircraft. Those two aircrafts, which I've been mentioning, are not that energy efficient in terms of oil, fuel, and spare parts. We really think that as we move forward, we will have a dedicated aircraft developed to cover for the needs of the region we are currently having to support the aircraft infrastructure of the region. So this is to overcome the issue of the runways, on the land runways. What kind of further steps can we take in terms of North Sea development, North Seaway development? We think that we will need to overcome a number of issues, but at the same time, with the development of a project, there will be new industries developed and new enterprises appearing on the territory of our region. The port of our city will support more operations with the development, and if this North Sea way is developed, we will have more opportunities to drive such industries as pulp industry and timber industry. So the two challenges we're facing is that there is a lack of transport opportunities to meet the transportation deadlines, so they want to reach their customers, so it's pretty simple, it's pure business. And if we have an additional opportunity in terms of transport, we will promote our port and connect it with the Northern Sea Route. We also want to stimulate other projects, including Belkomur Railroad, and also develop other capacities of the region to add more value to our city, to our businesses, and to the development of the Northern Seaway. Yesterday, we also talked to the fishermen, to fish processing plants and enterprises. There is an additional opportunity here as well in transporting fish to the central part of Russia. In this respect, we are better positioned in terms of distance connecting us to St. Petersburg and Moscow. So one of the issues here is to understand the tariff policy of ice-breaking operations, probably think of some tax breaks or preferences for businesses to step up the process. If we do that, we will be able to drive operations and then return to the profitable model, because these are the questions, these are the issues raised by businesses. Thank you, Viktor Mikhailovich. I give the floor to our next speaker, Yevgeny Ivan Frolov, Director, Arctic Antarctic Research Institute. I would like to mention that the Research Institute is a credible international leader in terms of ice-breaking forecasts and ice conditions forecasts, and a lot of companies are using the services of the Institute. Please, sir, you have the floor. Today, and as you know, there are a number of energy projects underway in the Arctic region, which are represented in this slide. And of course, the Northern Seaway itself is an important project. The implementation of these projects will drive the traffic of cargo in this region. By 2014, we had 4 million. So last year, it was 5 million. And by 2020, we expect the traffic will amount to 30 million tons and beyond. The success of these projects is based and depends on expertise and risk management. In this slide, you see the such risks as icebergs, ice compressions, seismic processes, climatic changes, as well as other challenges and issues. The growth of volume of traffic will require new icebreakers, new transport vessels, and using this opportunity, I would like to congratulate you all on commissioning the Arctic icebreaker Arctica, and I would like to congratulate Vladislav on that. And I think that the following ship of the second class will also be commissioned soon, and shortly we will have two powerful vessels online. We're facing the negative effects because of the technical limitations, which leads to lower attractiveness of the northern sea route. I think that raising the efficiency of the icebreaking fleet, icebreaking ships, is possible through driving and using, building on the expertise dating back to the 1980s, when we had a larger volume. There were 6 million of tons. The average traffic was 6 million tons, and the icebreakers were less powerful, but the ice was thicker. At that time, there was a sustainable system on icebreaking operations along the northern sea route. This framework included icebreaking support, navigation support, as well as surveys, hydrological support, and port support. There were various stakeholders responsible for managing these parts and administering the northern sea routes. There was a long-term planning and coordination of all the elements included in this framework. The focus was on providing traffic and capacity of the sea routes, planning as well as positioning of icebreakers, creating vessel groups depending on the icebreaking conditions. It was necessary to make such a system, such a framework functional, and for that reason we need to repeat, to replicate this experience. We need to create a new functional system considering the current context and conditions. Our research institute has developed the hydrological support system in the Arctic, which is currently operational and up and running in our institute. This system is based on the recent breakthroughs of science, and the consumers are mining companies, resource companies, as well as different agencies and administrations. We are ready to support this subsystem as part of the unified system I have been mentioning earlier. This framework, this new system, will help to provide better icebreaking and transport operations in the Arctic. It will help to create a top-down system, raising the efficiency and attractiveness of the North Sea route. In conclusion, a few points on the climate changes which we are seeing, which we are witnessing. The ice cover, the ice cap, is shrinking, and there are a number of other challenges which need to be taken into account within the big Arctic projects. So the minimum level for 2012 was 3.4 million square kilometers in September of that year, which was the total square of the ice cap. Then we saw growth there, reaching up to 5.2 million square kilometers. So that is the conditions were simple in 2012, but then they reached the average level. In my personal opinion, as we move forward and in the near decade, we will have around 5 or a bit higher level of ice conditions. So it's a good thing that we are constructing, we are building new icebreakers. So the challenge is to provide traffic for the northern marine routes.
Thank you, Ivan. So the ice cap will not melt for good. It will still be there. Okay, Mr. Viktor Alersky, Deputy Minister of Transport of the Russian Federation, and he's in charge of the Federal Agency for Marine and River Transport. So we've been talking about the area you're an expert on, and we would like you to sum up and respond to the challenges that have been identified. Thanks a lot. Hold on a minute. Well, I had my presentation ready, but I don't think it makes any point to read it. And I would like to thank you for the stamina that you have displayed to stay here, over here. And you are curious, and you are professionally interested in the agenda we are discussing. And I've joined the ministry in 2009, and one of the first papers that we've been reading was dedicated to the development of the Arctic. And this day, we've been talking about the issues that were raised a few years ago, and there is a progress achieved, and we shouldn't criticize ourselves for the drawbacks. There is a progress, as I said, and the whole community that is interested in the development of the Arctic, both the business community, the regulators, and just enthusiasts, they make their contribution. If you just give me 10 minutes or 15 minutes, I will touch upon the different areas and priorities. But if you can make it real fast, not just 10 minutes, because we would like to have a questions and answers session as well. Okay, I'll try to do that. Since we are the Ministry of Transportation, we are the regulators, and though some of you might think that everything has been done in with respect to the regulations, and there was a law on Northern Sea Route, the rules of shipping, setting tariffs, but that is not true. We keep improving the standards and rules related to the Northern Sea Route as well. After the enactment of the Polar Code, and it is the amendments of the two conventions. One is SOLAS, the other is MARPOL. We will have to adjust the rules of shipping. The ships are supposed to be issued with the certificates to be eligible for polar navigations, and so the rules for the shipping will have to be adjusted. That's what we are doing. Some time ago, jointly, we have been working hard to define the rules of passenger cruise liners in the polar off waters and in the ports of the Far East. And as you know, there are no immigration authorities in some ports, so we will have to make arrangements for the passenger cruise liners, and because it was not possible to plot the routes in the polar waters and in the ports of Kamchatka, Chukotka, and Primorsky region. So I would like to inform you that on Friday, the law was adopted, and so it was a second reading, and there will still be third reading, and if there are any corrections, it will be just editorial. And in short, the border regime with respect of the passengers, members of the crew that call on the ports of the Arctic basin and the Far East ports are not applied. And there is a list of the ports and port points, and those were indicated and designated by the respective authorities, not by the ministry, and it was agreed on. And surprise, surprise, the Ministry of Defense and the Interior Ministry agreed to provide the clearance authorization for the ports of call, and so that has been resolved. So mentioning the tariffs, to finish talking about the regulations, and talking about the tariffs with respect to the fishing industry, I think it, this issue could be resolved, and 5 or 6 rubles on top of the existing tariffs doesn't mean anything. And I communicate with the good faith fishers, and they tried to apply this new system of tariffs, and they said that it is okay, it is possible to operate under the new tariff systems. And those who are negligible, they still keep mumbling that it is too costly. With respect to using the Northern Sea route, I have been discussing this issue at length. And I am adherent and the champion of the development of the Northern Sea route. And though it is a water area, it is not an infrastructure. But well, we are used to treating it as an infrastructure, and though it's just a transportation lane. But I'm optimistic about the possibility or capacity of the Northern Sea Route use as a transit lane, especially for the container shipment. Let me try to explain why. There are 3 reasons for that. There are high capex for specialized ships. And first, I would like to support the idea that technically it is possible to achieve. Take the example of Norilsk Nickel. I think they spent $150 million for an ice class ship, but they still to have to request ice breaking support, because if there are no ice breakers, the speed of passage is only 2-3 knots, and so it is much more convenient to use ice breakers for expediting the passage. So it is still necessary to use high ice class ships, because the area is still ice infested, even if the icebreakers are there, and it is not possible to negotiate the passage in aboard a conventional ship. Even if the ship is operating for 3-4 months, then the question is how will it be used for the rest of the year? Because container industry is quite competitive, and the capacity of containers is growing. And if the actually steel and metal of which the containers are made of are also hauled, then the respective capex and opex are increased. We should think about the temperature regime, and we know how low the temperature in the Arctic could be. And another thing, we cannot guarantee the schedule when the Northern Sea Route is used, and it is absolutely essential for the container haulage. If we talk about the bulk freight It is possible to use the northern sea route for bulk cargo. And in this case, the port of Murmansk might be used, or the ports of Japan, or the northeast of China. But in my opinion, it is possible to handle several million tons of bulk freight. And the volume of freight depends on the cost of the bunker. If the bunker prices are low, then the volume of transit has dropped considerably. No need for any explanation. You just have to look into the statistics. And then getting back from what I said in the beginning, I am sure that it is necessary to keep, develop the Northern Sea Route for domestic utilization, for haulage of hydrocarbons. And businesses should invest into it. And please rest assured that a few years will pass. And I think in 2021, the volume will be 30 millions. So we didn't have more than 6.5 millions, but next year the volume is 2 times 6, I think. And after a few years, in 2018, the 5 million from Sabato will be added on top of it. And in 5 years, we will target the figure of 30 million. So we shall do that. We shall develop the route, but we should focus on specific areas. With respect of the Northern Sea Route in the Arctic, the state is trying to deliver even more than the businesses request. And the state is expecting a recipe, a piece of advice from somebody to make the things work. But we know what we need. We need ice breakers, and I think 3 more in the next 10 years will not be enough, because the service life of the existing ones are not limitless. So I think we need 3 plus 3 ice breakers, and it is necessary to do the survey of the channels that I used, because the tonnage is of the ships is growing, and we are doing that. We are doing the surveying and the depth measurement, and we have 35,000 of the depth measurement just last year, because if there's no depth measurement, then no charts are available, and no shipping company will dare it. We shouldn't forget about the charts, sea charts. Previously, the draft of the icebreakers were not that heavy. I think the draft of the icebreaker is 11 meters, and that's what the depth of the water that were required. Yeah, I think I meant to talk about money. Okay, about the structural, physical infrastructure. Reference was made to the development of Arkhangelsk and Murmansk and Petropavlovsk in the Far East, on Kamchatka. While trying to be humane, I sympathize with Arkhangelsk, because Arkhangelsk used to be the birthplace of the Northern Sea Route. But time changes, and the approaches change. New tasks are set, and Arkhangelsk is not part of it anymore for obvious drawbacks, like it is a port that gets frozen, and it is shallow water over there. And at the same time, Murmansk has a certain advantages, and it was a conscientious decision to develop a new port on the western side of the Kola Bay, and they say that well, it is the Ministry of Transportation that is getting the kickbacks, and it is just spending the money. But if that's the point of view, then I think we should be all put into custody. And I think all the advantages of the Murmansk should be used. And I think it is a crime to develop the port within the city limits. And that's why the western coast of the Kola Bay should be developed. We've been doing that kind of work despite the absence of the money in the state budget. So we have made use of the Gazprom Bank to sponsor it. As far as Petropavlovsk of Kamchatka is concerned, we have taken a decision with respect to the commercial ports. There'll be no castles in the sands because there's no need for that, and we will limit to the refurbishment of three terminals. The specifications will be 11 meters of draft, and we believe it will be enough, taking into consideration that the investors would build the warehouses, mechanization for cargo handling. And I'd not have too great expectations, but we shouldn't just mark time over there. We signed an agreement for design and engineering. The terminals are being designed now. And it was suggested that 20 billion rubles should be invested, but it will never be paid back. That is too much. So that's why right now the capex will be 2 billion only. The money will be provided by the Ministry of Transportation and the Ministry for the Development of the Far East. And this year we will finish the design and engineering. It will be the refurbishment of the port, a terminal, and the situation will change. A few years ago, there was a rusty iron gates over there with the signage, "Welcome to Kamchatka." And it will be a new area, and it will make a life easier for the passengers and for the cruise liners, because not all the passengers would be ready to jump into a lifeboat and to get from aboard the cruise liner to land on shore. I think that's about it. I will stop at where I am, and if you have any questions, I will be happy to answer them. Oh, yes, by the way, we've been talking about sea. But there's stand potential to develop the access roads to the ports of the sea, Northern Sea route, to additionally bring freight that is moving from north, from south to north, and it is located in the areas that is adjacent to the areas of the high north. And there might be a lot of freight to hold. And I just remember what my mother used to tell me. She was born in Dixon, and the villages where she used to live were just digging coal from the top soil. And there are a lot of mineral resources in the nearby areas, and capex are not high over there. And no one was calculating all the economical parameters because the transportation costs were too high. But the technologies of transportation are different now. There are different ships. There are different icebreakers, and the shipping is more efficient, and the costs of transportation are lower, if not drastically, but at least there'll be no increase of the costs of operation, and the tariffs for transportation will be quite optimum.
Well,
as an example, in 2017, there will be a start of the railroad construction between Bavanenkovo and Sabeta, and it will be possible to use the railroad for export. We'll see what will happen as a result, but I think there will be a certain bulk ingredient in Sabeta port.
Thank you for your input. I didn't want to interrupt you, and I wanted to leave out the questions instead so that all of us will have a chance to ask you many questions after today's meeting. We are coming closer to adjourning our today's session, and I would like to say thank you to all the participants and panelists. I really hope, and I think that you are much better professionals than I am. You are the real Arctic professionals, not me. And for people who look at what you do from side lookers, they understand that the Arctic will continue developing. We understand that it's our priority, and we need to be pragmatic about developing this territory and not be over enthusiastic. We remember the need to avoid over-regulation and remember all the concrete steps that are being taken. So I thank all the listeners, those of you who are last but not the least of all the participants of the forum, and I would like to thank you all for being here with us. Thank you.